One central theme throughout both the Tanakh as well as the New Covenant writings is the release from slavery. Whether that slavery is literal, such as the children of Israel being released from Egypt, or in a more spiritual and figurative sense, with our release from the bondage of sin. The Lord is faithful to His covenants, despite our shortcomings and our stubbornness. In our Haftarah reading this week, we return to the book of Jeremiah, where it opens with two rather profound and complex verses. Look at Jeremiah 33, 25 and 26. Thus says the Lord, if my covenant is not with day and night, and if I have not appointed the ordinances of heaven and earth, then I will cast away the descendants of Jacob and David my servant, so that I will not take any of his descendants to be rulers over the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. For I will cause their captives to return and will have mercy on them. Now why would this Haftarah open with these two verses and then skip to a section of the next chapter which focuses on slavery? Now, what is the connection? Now, as we dig deeper, we will see that this Haftarah is about much more than just slavery. The Torah portion title for this week is Mishpatim, which means enactments or judgments, and outlines the conditions and dispositions of slavery within the community of God's people. How were the slaves to be treated? Specifically, slaves who were themselves counted among God's chosen people. How are the biblical regulations of slavery and this story of Zedekiah in particular a picture of our redemption from slavery to sin by the blood of Yeshua? I'm Dan Cathcart, and this is Ancient Perspectives. The bulk of this week's Haftarah reading is concerning the covenant King Zedekiah made with the people involving the release of their Hebrew slaves. Zedekiah was the third son of the great King Josiah. Josiah was the last truly good king of Judah, leading the people in following the Torah of God. Now, all three sons of Josiah would sit on the throne of Judah following Josiah's defeat and death at Megiddo. But none would live up to the example of Josiah. But who is Zedekiah? Zedekiah was the last of Josiah's sons to obtain the throne by appointment. During Zedekiah's reign, Judah was a vassal kingdom, paying tribute as a subordinate to King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. Zedekiah came to power following a great captivity, when Judah had been stripped of most of its army, the entire priesthood, as well as many of their skilled artisans, merchants, and politically connected people. Now, the prophet Ezekiel, a contemporary of Jeremiah, himself a priest, was among the first group to be taken into captivity by the Babylonians. And the name Zedekiah was given to him by King Nebuchadnezzar. Let's go to 2 Kings 24. 15 through 17. And he carried Jehoiakim captive to Babylon, the king's mother, the king's wives, his officers, and the mighty of the land he carried into captivity from Jerusalem to Babylon. All the valiant men, 7,000, and craftsmen and smiths, 1,000, all who were strong and fit for war, these the king of Babylon brought captive to Babylon. Then the king of Babylon made Mattaniah, Jehoiakim's uncle, king in his place, and changed his name to Zedekiah. Zedekiah was really stuck between the proverbial rock and the hard place. He did not have the support of the people, who had again followed into rebellion, rejecting the Torah and the Lord's covenant with them, and he owed loyalty to Babylon and Nebuchadnezzar, who had put him into power. Now, what was Zedekiah to do? How could he survive this contradictory and politically dangerous position? And to top it off, Zedekiah receives a frightening message from Jeremiah regarding his fate. Look at Jeremiah 34, 1 through 3. The word of the Lord, which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, when Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and all his army, all the kingdoms of the earth under his dominion, and all the people, fought against Jerusalem and all its cities, saying, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, go and speak to Zedekiah, king of Judah, and tell him, thus says the Lord, behold, I will give this city into the hand of the king of Babylon, and he shall burn it with fire, and you shall not escape from his hand, but shall surely be taken and delivered into his hand. Your eyes shall see the eyes of the king of Babylon. He shall speak with you face to face, and you shall go into Babylon." Now, perhaps with the help of his closest friends and advisors, Zedekiah decided to enter into a covenant with the Lord and with the people. From the text, it's difficult to ascertain what his motive for doing this was. Now, was Zedekiah entering into this covenant out of conscience or for reasons of convenience? Now, regardless of the motive, it is clear that Zedekiah entered into a binding covenant with the people and with God. Look at Jeremiah 34, 8 through 10. This is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord after King Zedekiah had made a covenant with all the people who were at Jerusalem to proclaim liberty to them, that every man should set free his male and female slave, a Hebrew man or Hebrew woman, that no one should keep a Jewish brother in bondage. Now when all the princes and all the people who had entered into the covenant heard that everyone should set free his male and female slaves, that no one should keep them in bondage anymore, they obeyed and let them go. Now this was a covenant entered into by means of the ancient traditions where a sacrifice is made, the parts of the sacrificial animal are split into two, and the parties walk between them. The understanding was that the one who broke a covenant would then be treated as the covenant sacrifice and cut into two pieces. The covenant that Zedekiah made was to honor the Torah in regard to the treatment of slaves. Now, it had been more than 700 years since the children of Israel had been released from slavery in Egypt, and God had established them in their land and given them a system of laws where they were radically different than those common to the other Near East cultures. Now, generally, slavery at this time and throughout most of history was a particularly brutal practice. Slaves were treated as mere property, not unlike a piece of furniture or any other household item. The practice of slavery in Roman times is well documented and typical of the conditions of slaves in the ancient world. Now, since the death of Josiah, the children of Israel had ignored the Torah laws regarding the indentured servitude of fellow Hebrews and reverted to the common practice of the surrounding nations. Now, these laws are enumerated in Leviticus chapter 25. Let's take a look. Leviticus 25, 39 through 43. "And if one of your brethren who dwells by you becomes poor and sells himself to you, you shall not compel him to serve as a slave. As a hired servant and a sojourner, he shall be with you and shall serve you until the year of Jubilee. And then he shall depart from you, he and his children with him, and shall return to his own family. He shall return to the possessions of his fathers. For they are my servants, whom I brought out of the land of Egypt. They shall not be sold as slaves. You shall not rule over him with rigor, but you shall fear your God." The Torah says that their fellow Hebrews were to be treated with the same respect and dignity that one was to give to a neighbor or even a family member. But the Israelites of Zedekiah's time were not following the Torah. Zedekiah essentially renewed the provisions of the covenant regarding their brethren as indentured slaves, but their observance of this covenant was to be short-lived. Look at Jeremiah 34, verse 11. "But afterwards they changed their minds and made the male and female slaves return, whom they had set free, and brought them into subjection as male and female slaves." whatever spiritual revival resulted among the inhabitants of Judah at that time due to this covenant died right then and there. Jeremiah goes on to give a stern warning and prediction to Zedekiah. Look at Jeremiah 34, 12 through 16. Therefore, the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I made a covenant with your fathers in the day that I brought them out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage, saying, At the end of every 7 years, let every man set free his Hebrew brother, who has been sold to him. And when he has served you 6 years, you shall let him go free from you. But your fathers did not obey me, nor incline their ears. Then you recently turned and did what was right in my sight, every man proclaiming liberty to his neighbor, and you made a covenant before me in the house which is called by my name. Then you turned around and profaned my name, and every one of you brought back his male and female slaves, whom he had set at liberty at their pleasure, and brought them back into subjection to be your male and female slaves. By reclaiming their Hebrew slaves, they were violating several provisions of God's covenant with them. First, by forcing their former slaves back into a condition of slavery, they were, in effect, kidnapping them. At the point of their release, they had become liberated, or were once again free citizens, not in debt to anyone. They were now being taken into slavery outside the provisions outlined in Leviticus chapter 25. By reclaiming their slaves, they also profaned the name of God because they entered into this covenant in the precincts of the temple. And by reclaiming the people as slaves, they were also breaking their word to each other. God's judgment against the people is severe. But why did God's judgment fall on them at this time? The children of Israel had been violating various Torah laws and provisions for centuries. So as we read in the time of the judges and under the reign of all the kings of the northern tribes and many of those of Judah, their sins against God and each other appear far more extensive than this example in our Haftarah. So why now? Was God overreacting in his judgment? Jeremiah tells them what is to come. Let's look at Jeremiah 34, 17 through 20. Therefore, thus says the Lord, You have not obeyed me in proclaiming liberty, everyone to his brother and everyone to his neighbor. Behold, I proclaim liberty to you, says the Lord, to the sword, to pestilence, and to famine. And I will deliver you to trouble among all the kingdoms of the earth. And I will give the men who have transgressed my covenant, who have not performed the words of the covenant which they made before me, when they cut the calf in two and passed between the parts of it, the princes of Judah, the princes of Jerusalem, the eunuchs, the priests, and all the people of the land who passed between the parts of the calf, I will give them into the hand of their enemies and into the hand of those who seek their life. Their dead bodies shall be for meat for the birds of the heavens and the beasts of the earth. Now that's a harsh punishment for a single transgression of the Torah laws regarding slavery, especially in light of the fact that for centuries prior, both Israel and Judah were engaged in far greater sins that included idolatry, murder, and even the sacrificing of their own children. Now covenants are sacred, and they had made a covenant with God in the temple. And as such, God was not only a witness, but he was a party to this covenant. If the people were allowed to treat this covenant lightly, then it would leave the impression that God also treats his covenant obligations lightly. And this wasn't just any covenant. It was a covenant which dealt with slavery, the very thing that God released them from when they were in Egypt. Now, it's interesting to note that among the cultures of the Near East, the Bible is the only document which begins its list of enactments, or Mishpatim, with rules about slavery. In a commentary by the Jewish Publication Society, Nahum Sarna writes, The priority given by the Torah doubtless has a historical explanation. Having recently experienced liberation from bondage, the Israelite is enjoined to be especially sensitive to the condition of the slave. As we read in Exodus chapter 25, the Torah says that a fellow Hebrew who finds himself as a slave to another Hebrew is to have a special status. He is a brother and was not to be treated as Israel was treated when they were slaves in Egypt. When the people broke their covenant at this time, they also violated one of the most important Torah provisions and insulted God in the process. No wonder God's response was so severe. Judgment would come to Judah by the hands of the Babylonians. Look at Jeremiah 34, 21 and 22. "And I will give Zedekiah, king of Judah, and his princes into the hand of their enemies, and into the hand of those who seek their life, and into the hand of the king of Babylon's army, which has gone back from you. Behold, I will command, says the Lord, and cause them to return to the city. They will fight against it and take it and burn it with fire. And I will make the cities of Judah a desolation without inhabitant." Now, King Zedekiah would face judgment as well, but his life would be spared. His judgment would be to be taken into captivity in humiliation to face the Babylonian king. Jeremiah 34, 2 through 5. "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, go and speak to Zedekiah, king of Judah, and tell him, thus says the Lord, behold, I will give this city into the hand of the king of Babylon, and he shall burn it with fire, and you shall not escape from his hand, but shall surely be taken and delivered into his hand. Your eyes shall see the eyes of the king of Babylon, and he shall speak with you face to face, and you shall go to Babylon. Yet hear the words of the Lord, O Zedekiah, king of Judah. Thus says the Lord concerning you, you shall not die by the sword. You shall die in peace, as in the ceremonies of your fathers, the former kings who were before you. So they shall burn incense for you and lament for you, saying, alas, Lord, for I have pronounced the word, says the Lord." Now, even though the end of this Haftorah reading ends with Jeremiah's prophecy that the children of Israel will be defeated, the city of Jerusalem burned and left desolate, and King Zedekiah, along with the remaining population, taken off into exile in Babylon, we know that this isn't the end of the story. The two opening verses of this Haftorah reading would be best left to read at the end of this portion, so it might serve us to read them again. Look at Jeremiah 33, 25 to 26. "Thus says the Lord, if my covenant is not with day and night, and if I have not appointed the ordinances of heaven and earth, then I will cast away the descendants of Jacob and David my servant, so that I will not take any of his descendants to be rulers over the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. For I will cause their captives to return, and I will have mercy on them." And we can see that God takes his covenants seriously. God kept his obligations under this covenant, even though Israel and Judah did not. But how does this Haftorah relate to us and our relationship to God through Messiah Yeshua? When we accepted the sacrifice that Yeshua made, we too entered into a covenant relationship with God. Yes, we fail from time to time because of our flesh and our sin nature, but God is faithful to his obligation under this covenant as well. Our salvation is built upon his promise to never forsake his obligation to his covenants. Look at Hebrews 9, verse 15. "And for this reason, he is the mediator of the new covenant by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions under the first covenant, that those who are called may receive the promise of the eternal inheritance." Now, just like with Israel, God may prescribe discipline on us, yet just like the promise to the people of Judah in Zedekiah's time, God will always remain faithful to his people and he will restore them. And we are of no exception. God kept his promise to the children of Israel and brought them back from their captivity and restored their nation once again. And the modern state of Israel owes her very existence to God's covenant promises, and so do we. Yeshua reminds us of his covenant-keeping promise in John's Gospel. Look at John 10, 26 through 30. But you do not believe, because you are not my sheep. As I said to you, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. We have learned that this Haftarah is indeed about much more than slavery. It's all about the nature of covenants and their importance in our relationship with the Lord of hosts. It's about his unfailing covenant-keeping nature and his promise to all who call on his name. Just as the battered and beaten Israel needed to be reminded of God's covenantal promise to them and their relationship to him through his covenant, so do we who claim to know Messiah Yeshua. Just like the children of Israel, we also from time to time will fall victim to our own shortcomings. But by our reliance on and our faithfulness to his word, we are reminded that we have entered into a covenantal relationship with him through a better sacrifice and by extension, a better promise. He will forever, always be faithful to that covenant. I'm Dan Cathcart for Moed Ministries International. Shalom and be blessed.